Welcome to Concepts of Programming Languages. In this video, I want to talk about computer programming, algorithms, and computability. This video is about, let's say, the foundational aspects of computer science and programming. So, what is computer programming, actually? It's a very natural question you could ask yourself. And the answer can be given simply by saying that computer programming is specifying what computers do, or specifying the behavior of computers. And computers compute. But then you still have the question, hey, but what is computing then? Well, to give an answer to that, you can simply think of computing as the process of step-by-step calculation. And there are many theoretical models of computing. Yeah, there is the Turing machine, there is the lambda calculus, there are many numerous examples of models of computing. Moreover, in practice, you can also see a lot of physical realizations of computing. Eh? I mean, the desktop or laptop or phone you're watching this video on is a computing device. And there are servers, controllers, satellites. I mean, lots of computing happening in the real world. Okay, but then you can ask yourself the question, but why do we actually compute in the first place? And this question is quite philosophical in nature. There is a nice article by Samson Abramsky who mentions two puzzles about computation. And he asks the question, why do we compute? Well, why do we compute? It can, for instance, be answered by saying, well, we compute to gain information. You start with a problem, you describe what the computer's behavior will be, and then you let the computer work, it ends and it gives you an answer, and that gives you more information. But Samson Abramsky has some additional questions about that simple answer. And you could, for instance, think of, well, suppose we build a satellite. And on board there is a computer, and we send the satellite in outer space. It has absolutely no intention of returning to Earth. It just goes and goes and goes and goes. Well, is then that device on board computing? Because since it's going further and further and further away, we at some point don't receive anything from it, let's say, then is it then still computing or not? But by the way, this is nice to come back a little in the previous video. It was also an idea of von Neumann to build self-replicating satellites, eh? And send them in outer space. Yeah, if you think of it, is that then actually still computing? Or is it necessary for us to retrieve the result? Okay, enough philosophy. Although... I do want to ask you the question. We've seen many physical realizations of computing, but some are so entirely are so complex that can you then imagine what it is computing in the first place? So, for instance, consider the internet with all its million connected devices, all linked to each other, sending information, retrieving information. And all this activity going on, obviously it's computing. But the question is, what is it computing? What is the internet computing? Also there, it's very difficult to give an answer. Okay, enough philosophy, let's continue. To really understand computers, you need to be one. And this may sound absurd the first time you hear it, but actually it's not. Because there was also a time in which we didn't have all these computing devices around us, and it were the humans who were computing. So you can also be a computer if you have a trained, disciplined thought. So your thinking process is rigorous. You follow rules step by step in a very precise manner. Well, then you are a computer. And you compute. And this is, for instance, what you learn in school when you do addition. You would do addition following along the rules of additions. Now, the human computation process is fallible. As we know, humans fail. Humans make errors. So whenever you have a large computation and you want humans to compute, there is a high chance that errors will creep in. And moreover, humans are slow. So this eventually led to the development of mechanized computers. A nice book that explains to you, at least for in the Netherlands, the development of the computer, is the book Geheugentrommels. It's in Dutch. The book describes how in the Netherlands the computer was developed. Or at least the first computers were developed in the Netherlands. And also there, the book starts with the need to do the computation, which was performed by humans. And at some point, the computational load became so large. Hey, why don't we investigate whether we could automate that process? So if you think of it, many people fear for their jobs because computers are taking over the world. It's actually quite funny that the human computers were the first to be automated away. Okay. Talking about computation and explaining what computation is, does it really matter who or what executes the computation? It's central to the notion of computation is the intuitive idea of an algorithm. And an algorithm consists of a description of what input is acceptable. Where do you start? An algorithm describes the rules, so that allowing you to do step-by-step calculation. And the algorithm describes what output may be produced. Now, an example of an algorithm would, for instance, be addition, like you learned at school. You have as input two numbers separated by a plus symbol. The rule is to perform addition on the given numbers, and the output is again a number. So an example of a computation would be 3 plus 4 is 7. And so the 7 is the output of the algorithm, and the 3 plus 4 is the input of the algorithm. Intuitively, this idea is clear. Now, think critically about the output of an algorithm. An algorithm describes what output may be produced. So, another algorithm would be, let's call it the running forever algorithm. You start as an input with a number. Now, there is the rule that you repeatedly add one to the given number, and the output is nothing. So then the computation looks like you start with, say, two, and then you add one and you obtain three, then you add one to three and you obtain four, then you add one to four and you obtain five, and so on, and so on, and so on. So this is also an algorithm. Okay. So this gives us an intuitive idea of what an algorithm is. But now, can we do more than that? Can we know what an algorithm is? Well, for that, you could study models of computation. And models of computation are formal notions, they're mathematical constructions. You could understand computation mathematically. Now, I'll try to explain what you could do with that. So suppose that we are given some model of computation, and this is some mathematical construction. Then you could say that a given mathematical function, let's say f, is then m computable, so it's computable in your model of computation m, if it is the case that for every x, there exists a computation in your model, which whenever you give x as an input, eventually the computation halts, and then an output is produced, namely fx. So whenever this is the case for a function f, we call it m computable. So if this is a definition of m computability for a function f, you could imagine forming the class of m computable functions, so that consists of all functions f such that this definition holds of it, that f is m computable. Well, this is a good starting point for understanding computability in a mathematical way. Now, turns out that there were several foundational models of computation that were given. One of them was Stephen Kleene's recursive functions. So it is a mathematical model of computation. Another one, surprisingly at the same time, was Alan Turing's Turing machines, as we call them today, also at the same year. And we have Alonzo Church's lambda calculus. These three are mathematical models of computation. So you could then ask, well, the class of computable functions according to Kleene's recursive functions, what is that in relation to the class of computable functions in relation to Turing's notion of computability or Church's notion of computability? And it is quite surprising that it turned out that all these three models of computation are equivalent. So that means that the class of Kleene's computable functions is equivalent to the class of Turing's computable functions, is equivalent to the class of Church's computable functions. So, and considering that these three mathematical constructions were devised sort of independently, this has suggested that this is quite a foundational notion that was discovered. So it is nowadays called the Church-Turing thesis that our intuitive notion of what an algorithm is best captured by one of these three computational models. We call them equivalent. But this is a thesis. I mean, the notion of algorithm is intuitive, so it's not like a mathematical object. You cannot prove the Church-Turing thesis in any way. But it is a nice way of thinking that, okay, anything that we consider computation, computable, can be understood if you understand one of these three. So later in this course, we will also look at the lambda calculus. And basically, if you understand the lambda calculus, you understand everything there is to understand, eh? But it is not that simple, but we will try. Now, considering the fact that these three notions are all equivalent, we could also just speak of the class of computable functions. And that basically means one of these. They're equivalent anyway. Now, you might have heard of it before, and otherwise I will explain, but there is also this concept of a Turing-complete programming language. So what this means is that the programming language that you use has a relation to one of these foundational models of computation, and typically the Turing machine is taken. So what that means precisely is if you have a programming language, and a programming language is a formal language with a certain meaning, that's an unambiguous intention to compute. If you can show that your programming language can do everything that a Turing machine can do, then you call your programming language Turing complete. And how do you show that? Well, you show that for every Turing machine, there exists a program which has the same behavior as that Turing machine. And then you can call your programming language Turing complete. Okay. So, well, then you can still ask yourself a question, namely, this class of computable functions, does it comprise every function? Is every function computable? Well, you could answer that by phrasing it negatively. Do there exist functions that are not computable? And it turns out, yes, there are functions that are not computable. And I'm talking about mathematical functions here. So, if there are functions that are not computable, well, give me one. Sure. So, let P stand for a program in some Turing complete programming language. Yeah, and this program P takes as an input some string of symbols, and as output it produces a number. So, P is an arbitrary program in our Turing complete programming language. We can then ask ourselves, well, when we start the execution of P with some input being a string of symbols, X, will the computation then halt? Will at some point the computation end? And this question is called the halting problem. Now, given the halting problem, we can then define a mathematical function, let's call it f halt, which takes two, well, let's call it arguments. It takes an arbitrary p and an arbitrary x, and the mathematical function is defined to be 1 whenever p halts with input x. And so the computation where you take the computation described by program p, if you supply it the input x and that computation halts, then this mathematical function gives you a 1. And this mathematical function gives you a 0, or specified to be equal to 0, whenever p does not halt, if you supply that input x. And now it is a theorem that f halt is not computable. So remember, f halt is a function, it's a mathematical function, the definition is shown on the screen, and the function is computable, we've seen a definition of that before. Maybe I can go a little bit back to show you the definition of computable. Now, this definition is specifically for a model of computation, but you can take any, because they are equivalent anyway. So, the essential point is that f is computable whenever there is a computation where if you supply x as input for every possible x, this computation halts, and the result of the function fx is then produced as output. Okay, let's get back. So f halt is not computable. And how do we prove that? We can prove that by contradiction. So that means, suppose that f halt is computable. Well, we have seen the definition of computable before. So that means, by definition, that there must exist some program Q in our Turing complete programming language, such that that program Q takes as input a string P and a string X, and executing the program always eventually halts, regardless of the input P or X, and then produces F halt P of X as an output, as the function specifies. So, okay, because we have assumed f halt is computable, we know that this program must exist. That is by definition of computable. But if this program exists, then there exists also another program. And you already have an ID, an intuitive ID of how you could construct algorithms. Well, if we know we have the program Q, we could also have a program D, which takes a single string as input, and it is defined or programmed to, if you give it an input P, that it then runs forever. We have already seen an algorithm that runs forever, so you can do that. So D runs forever whenever you have tested at the beginning whether if you execute Q with the inputs P and P. So you take P both as the first input and the second input, if that outputs a 1. And since you know that Q, for every possible input, P and X always halts and produce the output, it's fine. So whenever Q with the inputs P and P halts and produces 1, then our program D starts to run forever. However, if Q with the inputs P and P gives you back a 0 and it always gives you something back, well, then our program D will halt. So now the program D surely halts, because if you supply P and P to Q, then it must halt, and either it produces a 0 or it produces a 1. Right? So, and if it produces the 0, then our program D will also halt. Now, the next step is if we analyze the computation of program D whenever we supply it with itself as input. So what happens then? If D is supplied with input D, then it will run forever, and that's stated here, it will run forever, if Q of D, D equals 1. But Q D, D was defined as, that was the program Q here, it produces F halt. And F halt was a function that was defined to give a 1, that's on the previous slide. F halt gives a 1 if the program P halts with input X. And it gives a 0 if P does not halt on input X. So that means that if we supply D with input D itself, then it runs forever if D, if Q here with the D and D, this represents the halting problem for program D. So, okay, if D with input D then halts, right, then our Q of D, D must give a 1. Well, and then our D, our program D, starts to run forever. So if D with input D halts, then it runs forever. Now, in the other case, if you have D with input D and it runs forever, well, if it runs forever, then we know that the F halt of D, D must be 0. It's running forever, but then it must halt. Well, this is clearly a contradiction. Thank you for watching this video. Good luck with studying the literature, and I hope to see you soon.